safe. This is why I shouldn't have technology.
All right, so my talk is, what is oral history and why does it matter? First off, I want to, geez Louise. So I'm 17 seconds in and now I'm on Tony's slides. Okay, thank you. The bottom one, there we go. Thank you to the people in the back for helping me with technology. Thanks to all the students involved in TEDx. Great. Thanks to Tony for setting the bar high. My mentor at Idaho State University, Ron Hatzenbuehler, started many a formal presentation with warnings and disclaimers. So I got a couple warnings and a couple disclaimers. Warnings first, there will be pop culture references, most very esoteric. The second warning is there will be name dropping, such as Ron Hatzenbuehler. The disclaimers, a lot of what you will hear me say, I've said before, a lot of it in the Wisconsin Humanities Council's blog, Humanities Booyah, might be the best name of a blog ever, and its content is just as good. The other disclaimer is, I'm creating a cardinal sin of presentation here. Sometimes my images won't match my words, but I want you to give something to look at besides me. And the oral history program is part of the UW-Madison archives, and we have over 2 million images, and I'll be showing a few of them. There's a great story behind this slide, but my wife and daughter are in the audience, so I'm a little too bashful. I'm sorry, is that a bad joke? So I'm going to talk about what is oral history first, and to do that, I want to talk about my first formal oral history presentation. It was the fall of 1999, and it was in Moscow, Idaho. So I was the state oral historian for the Idaho State Historical Society. My official job title, no kidding, was historian, comma, oral. Awesome. So I was asked by a professor of history at the University of Idaho, Kathy Aiken, if I would travel north from Boise to Moscow to talk to her graduate students. So I did, and I was nervous. I brought 3x5 cards. So before PowerPoint slides, kids, there were 3x5 cards. I brought 3x5 cards. As I started speaking, between the tension in my arm and the sweat, I basically melted through them. I was speaking at a word per minute count that rivaled the 1980s spokesperson for Federal Express commercials. If you don't know who that is, YouTube that. About a minute in, a student had his hand up. And I thought I'd engage someone to a point where they had a question. So I looked at him and I said, yeah, you have a question. He had two, actually. Who are you and what are you doing here? So I thought about that over 18 years now. And at its core, I think what he was asking really was, what is oral history and why does it matter? So that's what I'm going to talk about today. This is not a picture of Idaho. This is a picture of a small town in Idaho, Arco, Idaho, where my grandparents spent most of their life. And my parents went to school and met. Okay, so what is oral history? There are dozens and dozens of written publications. There is great online resources, like from my colleagues at the Baylor University Institute for Oral History, who we didn't beat in basketball this year, but we beat every other time, so that's been awesome. Go Badgers. And the Oral History Association, the OHA, who have the perfectly named URL, easy to remember, oralhistory.org. But since I'm here, I'm going to talk a little bit about what I think what oral history is. And I'm going to start with these three bullet points. This is a slide brought to you by the letter C and the number 3. And only people who grew up watching Sesame Street get that reference. And this is also Crazy Legs. A lot of people think that Crazy Legs is just a race that we run in the spring. Crazy Legs was an actual person. Elroy Crazy Legs Hirsch. So let's talk a little bit about collecting. So just a couple of things about collecting on the idea of what is oral history. So collecting, to collect oral history, you need to be a well-trained, well-prepared interviewer. You need to do your research to be able to ask good, specific, open-ended questions of the people you're interviewing or the topic that you're interviewing them about. And you want to record it either using a digital audio or a digital audio video recorder. I annoy my friends by saying it audio video instead of video, but a noted videographer told me once, Troy, any good video is about 90% audio. So I continue to annoy my friends by calling it audio video. So on the guise of curating, once you have this digital file, whether it be audio or audio video, you want to make sure that you put it in as many places as possible. The acronym we like to use is LOCKS, L-O-C-K-S-S, stands for lots of copies, keep stuff safe. Yeah. Once you have those digital files, you also want to create some sort of data, metadata, or a finding aid to help unlock those digital files for either you, if you're doing the interviews, or future generations if you donate these interviews to an archive. And whether you're doing one oral history or an oral history project, you should communicate about it in some way. You should celebrate. You can do that in formal ways, such as a book or a journal article or a museum exhibit. You can do it in more modern ways, like a web page or a podcast. You might even get the chance to be video captured for a TEDx talk if you talk about oral history that way. I don't know who that's happened to recently, but. Let's move on. So I'm sorry, I have to talk about fake news, but not the kind you're thinking of. What you see here are three examples of what I've been calling oral history of fill in the blank. These are journalists and bloggers who use the term oral history incorrectly. So why are they using it incorrectly? Well, they do collect. They conduct interviews for either Making Jumanji with Robin Williams or Brett Favre's Greatest Game, or I'm Too Sexy. I'm not too sexy, it's I'm Too Sexy. They'll conduct interviews, they synthesize those interviews down to the juicy bits so they communicate about it in a website, but there's no preservation. Like, you could not go and get the full interviews to any of these posts, neither in audio nor in audio video. So no preservation, no curation of oral history. There is no oral history police. I can't get them to stop doing this. I can just get on my soapbox every time I get a chance to. And so I'm going to step off my soapbox for now and move on. So more about what is oral history. And let's talk a little bit about what oral history is in regards to memory. So most people do oral history not to get just the facts, man. We're not doing surveys or questionnaires. We're not doing closed questions. As I said before, we're doing oral history with open-ended questions, and we're trying to get at historical memory, people's historical memory. Probably the best example of this, or the best quote of this, is a well-known oral historian, Mike Frisch, who wrote a well-known book in oral history circles called A Shared Authority. I am not allowed to riff on the gospel of Frisch, as we like to call it, so I need to read the quote directly, so I apologize. But Mike Frisch says, oral history emerges as a powerful tool for discovering, exploring, and evaluating the nature of the process of historical memory. So what oral history does is it captures memory in all its richly complex and beautifully flawed ways. One more thing about oral history and memory. Oral history and memory can help counteract some of the downsides of collective memory or ritual consensus. What do I mean by that? Well, let's take a look at this 1938 men's Badger basketball team. Let's say they met in 1988 upon the 50th anniversary. They would probably leave that meeting with a collective memory of their season based on discussions they had, based on formal and informal presentations they might have done, based upon chats they had over peers. If we had done oral history with these 19 basketball players, we would have individual, discrete oral history that would not only talk about the Badger men's basketball team from 19 different angles, but also talk about the history of campus in the 30s. And maybe, just maybe, we would have the definitive story about number 27's black eye. Don't know what happened to him, but there's a story there, I'm sure. So I want to move on from oral history and memory to talk about oral history and technology. The only thing I remember from my undergraduate introductory to theater class is the term deus ex machina. And I truly don't remember what it means for the theater. What I do think I remember is that you can't tell a story about oral history without telling about how technology has helped advance oral history's plot, sometimes through some difficult situations. Let me tell you something you probably already know. Oral historians do not run the digital recording technology market. In 2000, on advice, I bought a digital audio tape or DAT player because it was the next big thing. I don't know how many of you got on board the DAT craze of 2000. Let me tell you, it wasn't. I think I may have bought it the 15 minutes it was actually on. So oral history and technology recently, Oral History in the Digital Age is a grant-funded project. It happened earlier this decade. It was led by one of my most valued colleagues, Doug Boyd, at the University of Kentucky. He led this two-year grant, which ended up with a symposium, a website, and I did a screen grab of the website there, Oral History in the Digital Age. And also, it led to an issue of the Oral History Review. This must have been my favorite journal I was involved in, because that's a big smile. A special issue of Oral History in the Digital Age. Doug also, while OHDA was going on, created something called OMES, Oral History Metadata Synchronized, and I'll talk about that in a second when I talk about today's tools. I need to talk about the Oral History Review. I am the managing editor of the Oral History Review. I have been since 2012, and I will be for the next 3 weeks. I'm not getting fired. We just have six-year terms. My boss is Kathy Nascrum from the University of San Francisco. Kathy has single-handedly made the Oral History Review, revivified it, made it one of the best humanities journals around. She's a great developmental editor. She's a great professional. She's an even better person. She is to the OHR and to me what donuts are to Homer Simpson. And by that I mean everything. So, Kathy, if you're watching. So let's talk more about, about today's tools. So, what we can do with today's tools is it allows us to be able to be more portable, so we can interview people anywhere. And this really helps, I think, for communities whose voices have not been heard, who haven't had the agency to be able to tell their story. The Zoom H2N is a very small portable recorder there. Most of us, either in our pockets or in our hands, I see some people have them in their hands, have a digital audio or digital video recorder. This has really helped be able to gather as much oral history as we can, and even do something called the Oral History of Our Time. The default backwards, I thought it was forward. We're now at the University of Maison. Other parts of today's tools that are invaluable to oral historians, we're now able to go back to extant content on analog cassette and open reel. We're able to digitize those to create digital files that then people can go back to and listen, easily listen to interviews done in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s that we weren't able to listen to as easy previously. And then the web, just new advancements in the web and things like OMES that I mentioned earlier have allowed us to actually put audio or audio video on the web and not just transcripts as PDFs. So all this taken together has really moved oral history forward into the 20th century thanks to the digital age. All right, so why does it matter? I'm gonna get back on my soapbox briefly. And talk about, so why does it matter? Why is this guy up here railing against these websites that use oral history incorrectly? Well, the misuse of the term cheapens and trivializes what myself and my colleagues do. And it also does a disservice to the almost 80 years of recorded oral history that we have, not only here in the US, but the world. It's more nostalgia than history. And don't get me wrong, I love nostalgia. My wife and I have rewatched like every episode of MASH on TV Land the last 3 months. So I get nostalgia, but history is different. Oral historians are scrupulous. We dive in, we do interviews for posterity for the generations and the generations after. Our work matters. Memorial Terrace right there. Just as Memorial Terrace matters to a lot of us here, either who work or who went to school here, oral history matters. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about a laundry list of reasons why oral history matters. And that, I think that cheapens, and I don't mean it to cheapen. These are important reasons why we do oral history. So oral history helps create a primary source for future or current or future generations. Just like there's a visual record and just like there's a written record, there's an audio or audio video record now. thanks to my colleagues and I doing oral history. Oral history can empower communities, again, particularly underrepresented communities or communities that haven't had the agency to be able to tell their story or preserve their story. Oral history can do that. Allow them to not only tell their story, but be able to present their story in the way that they want. Oral history also connects people that at first blush may not have much in common. And by that I mean oral history can enhance cross-cultural, cross-political, cross-generational understanding. I think in this day and age, all three of those things are very important. Oral history always also requires us to slow down, be present, and listen. So I've talked a lot about the bells and whistles of the digital age. But oral history at its core is an interviewer that is well-trained and well-prepared, talking to a narrator or a community of narrators who are ready, willing, and able to speak. You can have all the bells and whistles in the world, but if you don't have that dynamic between the interviewer and the narrator, you don't have oral history. It also offers a chance to bring the past to life. And it's there that I will begin to conclude. At the end of the workshops and presentations I give, I talk about the power of oral history. And the power of oral history to me is the power of the human voice, to be able to hear or to see and hear someone tell their story. So instead of playing an excerpt or two, I'm going to read from an email. Yep, I'm going to read an email. But I figured you've come this far with me, perhaps you have a few minutes further. So I love my job. Best days on my job are when I get an email like this. Excuse me, I'm too vain to wear bifocals. I'm writing to inquire about the cassette tapes in your archives on which my grandmother, Elizabeth Tarco's, interview is stored. I recently inherited the transcription from my grandfather, Harold Tarco. I would very much like to hear the original since I've never met my grandfather, or grandmother, excuse me. So we had this interview digitized. We put it up in the cloud, gave her a web link, I sent an email with those facts. And 2 hours later, she emailed back. Thank you so much for getting back to me regarding my grandmother's interview. It means so much to me to be able to hear her voice for the first time. It's truly a unique and rare gift you and the Oral History Program have given me. Thank you again, Shoshana Tarco. So on a micro level, oral history matters because if done well, it can bring family, generations of families together. And if I may quote myself here, sometimes on my job, I get to bring the dead back to life. And for me, that's what matters the most.